I need to thank Dave and Sam. When I received the phone call from Dave asking to come, I felt really happy and proud about it, because it's already appeared that we are challenging together, and to see them today driving their company and keeping to do KRA in UK, it's very nice for me. So to start, I need, but I will be short, to give you a short background of where KRA is coming from, because I believe we need to know the background to understand why some of the products look to be so crazy and out of the box. It's not only about craziness. Of course, it's a good part of it. So, in the early 90s, we established, me and other two shareholders, the company that was HP Sound, that today is the mother company of KRA. But we met each other a few years before in a very small rental company. I was studying at that time. I was kind of 16. And during the summer, I was spending my holidays there to grab some money. And the company was involved in small local rental and installation in churches. So drills and XLR cable and so on. And in the 90s, one of the three decided to start his own business. I was at university at that time, and he convinced me to leave the studies and to join him in this company. So we started our own very small operation, and we were doing rental and installation as well. But since the very beginning, we design and produce our speaker and our mics and our electronics. And that was mostly related to me. I had that passion since when I was 12. I was living in a very small village close to Florence, and that was the period in which the families were changing their TV set from tubes one to transistor one. And there was a very small shop with outside a pile of tube TV set. And I asked the guy if I could dismount the speakers from this TV set. And he allowed me, and that's how I started to play the speaker. I fell in love with them, and I discovered the difference between serial and parallel connection, the difference about a low-range speaker and a high-range speaker, and so on. So when we started also designing product. And in 95, 96, some of the Italian pro audio company, but also international one, saw some of our products in the market. It was really an artisanal production, and asked us to design and lately to produce for them some speakers, mic, and mixers. That one is a very funny design. I don't know if some of you saw in the market at that time. It looks like a laptop, small faders to control the input channels. It had 8 mic channels that can switch mic or line, and 2 per 200 watts amplifier inside. And the dimension at that time were really challenging, because it was that size, just a bit thicker, but it was that size. After this experience, we work also for other international company, especially in the design of the product. We decided in 2000 to enter the market with our own brand. That was the brand at that time that was more related to MI market. So we had microphones in that line, we had speakers, and also some outboard. That this one was a kind of a tube preamp. That brand was mostly dedicated to the Italian market. We had at that time a distributor here in UK that was doing kind of a nice small business, something in Spain, but the 70-80% of the business was in Italy. And in 2005, we understood that our roots were more related to the pro market. And we decided to try the challenge to move the line from the MI market to the pro market back. And the idea was to design a product that could really shake the market somehow. So we were looking for the possibility to have the attention of the media, of the pro guys. And we restarted from scratches, and we decided that whatever was in the market at that time was of course to be considered, but not necessarily was the perfect solution to the problem. And we restarted to consider which were the problem we faced when we were doing our own rental, when we were setting up the system, when we were in an environment. And we lined up all these key features that we wanted in a system. And the idea was to have the system as compact as possible, as light as possible, as powerful as possible, and to have the possibility to manage the energy also on the low mid frequencies. Of course, everything seems to be natural, but not all the systems in the market are taking care about it. So the first product that came out for the pro market was the combination between KH4 and KS4. Those two are normally subs in the stack that really look kind of unique, especially at that time. And they were based on a kind of dipole loading, so there's not really a box. There's a damping material on the back, and that helps to create the polar pattern that is not exactly an 8-figure. But at that time, it was really for us the first approach to this new idea and this new concept. What we achieved, it's been the attention of the market in a while. As soon as we introduced the first proto in Frankfurt, we found distributors all over, and we understood that couldn't make sense to brand it with our original brand that was known as MI product. And we decided to register this new logo because the line, we called it K Array in the other brand as a line of product. And K was related to Kevlar because the very first prototype was was made by Kevlar. The chassis was a Kevlar chassis. Then on the development of the product, we found a lot of nightmares related to Kevlar associated to high vibrations and stuff like that. That for this product, we came back to plywood almost at the very beginning, but we kept the K. And funny enough, something that was in our idea, a product to start just a new line in our catalog, became a new brand and then became a new company. We understood at that time, of course, we asked questioning ourselves why it's been so successful and why nobody else try to approach in a different way this kind of necessity in the market. And I believe that the answer, it's easy. The big brands, the big companies doesn't need really to make revolutions. It's much more comfortable to go step by step. They have their business and they are driving it properly. For a small brand, the knowledge and the research and development that you need to create something like that is normally too much to afford. So that's why it's not easy to see big revolutions in the market, because the big ones are going strategically slowly and the small ones cannot afford it. So we took the challenge, and after that, we developed our other lines. So we understood that the approach of a column speaker that was already in the market, the column speaker, I believe, are maybe one of the first approach that there were in the pro audio market. But nobody were really thinking of them for pro audio market and big installations. They were more related to MI or to churches or to small conference room. The idea to create a portable PA that can really serve a live band or a live gig was not really at that time normal in the market. So we developed the Cobra column as an array of 2 inches, very compact one, and the idea of everything inside, the remote control, the DSP, the touch screen, and so on. And in the meantime, we developed very small stuff. I don't know if you had ever the chance of seeing and listening to the small lizard or the piccolo, that are small arrays, big like a finger, made by 4 pieces of half an inch drivers that of course cannot cover all the band, but we normally crossover them around 350-400 and gives enough the feeling that the sound is coming from there and you can hide the sub in the area. And also those one that are made in aluminium, that's another characteristic of the most part of our product. We are using metal for the chassis. And especially in this case, the chassis itself became the head sink of the speakers. That's allow you to apply a much more higher average power to the speaker, because the magnets use the chassis to as a head sink. So they are thermically in contact with the chassis. Oh, la la, I crashed it. So, to recover. Yeah. Okay. And the fact to be strong against the environment is a key feature for our product. So we normally use stainless steel and aluminium for the most part of the products. And also the screws and all the details are anti-corrosion. So you can use them on the seaside or on a ship. There are cruise ships with speaker installed outdoor already for years. And when we arrived in 2012, after 7-8 years from the first array, and we understood that there was the need of an evolution of this first product that created the name, we decided that also in the new generation we should keep all the advantages of the previous one, but one of the point was to be absolutely compliant with the environmental needs. So the idea to be IP64 was a kind of a must for the product. And after this one, then we will step back, of course, because this is the focus of our conversation. We developed also what we call the Concert Series, because this one is part of the Firenze Series, that is for us is a kind of a Formula One team in our range. We kept in this line all the advantages that we developed on the Firenze, we brought to the concert. When we decided to redesign the concert and the Firenze series, we understood that we couldn't do everything by ourselves, because the challenge became in the meantime bigger. And that's why we decided, first of all, to contact Stefan. I visited him in Berlin and we talked a lot, because there were the very early days of Filmmaker and was exactly what we were looking for. So we got aligned on the target of the system and the software. And we develop side by side the software on one side and the product on the other to to achieve the maximum between them. And we created a project and we apply a request of financement and we won a tent. So the European community paid a part, just a part of course, but it was of a great help of the development of the food project, because they found the innovation about it. And in the development of this project, it's been a great part, Mario, that today is with us. He has got a great company with great guys inside that are of a great help both on the development side of the products and then also on the support on the market after the product is there. And I leave to Mario the technical background and everything that is new in our approach, and then I will come back to you. Thank you.
Okay, hi to everybody. Okay, so good afternoon. I will continue the speech, part of the technical speech from Alessandro to explain you some of the things that we wanted to include in this development at that time. So at the end of this job, we also decided to create a paper for we gave an AES presentation in the last conference in New York City last autumn. And so this part will be an excerpt from that presentation to show you what kind of results we were looking for, what kind of innovation we wanted to include into this system. Of course, some of this innovation comes from the KRA heritage that Alessandro already gave you a glimpse of. And but I'm consulting. I'm part of this company, a consulting company. It's called Audio Lab Systems in Italy. But we are a partner with KRA from 2008, and so a little bit of this technology was already part of the KRA heritage. And then we made some step ahead together to develop this technology, thinking to the real needs of the sound reinforcement. And so when we speak about large-scale sound reinforcement, we are referring to a number of situations where large-scale sound reinforcement is dedicated to reinforce the speech or the music in a very different variety of application. And of course, among this application, concert sound is one of maybe the most important, or maybe the most delicate to be held, and also is a very important market, because most of the reputation that sound enforcement system get along its life comes from the concert sound as well as other application. But there are a bunch of other things like sport, religious event, political events, social events, where you need a large scale sound enforcement, and you also need that this sound enforcement will give you specific performances. Of course, if we think a little bit about how the sound enforcement has been developed in the last, let's say, 40 years, 30 years. Of course, we have moved from something that was based on the idea of developing a box, whatever it would be, and then try to see what happened when you put a bunch of them together. I would call this bottom-up approach. So this was from the 70s. We were most of the designers were designing a box because the first applications were based on the use of very few box, and then somebody started to add more and more and more again, creating bigger and bigger and larger events. But of course, the very important revolution that came with line array, it was a change in a design approach that we can call like a top-down approach, that where the designer was mostly trying to get a big speaker design, like a big speaker that can suit to the venue need, and then design it in a way that would be easy to divide it in slices, just to be easy to transport and to be moved and sold and sold around the world. So this is in my opinion, it's not a trivial change. It's a very radical change in the approach, because with the approach of to line array, the overall idea of array optimization had been simplified, and get rid of the idea of having anything optimized, and then accept the idea that if we can have the speaker managing the horizontal dispersion, we can just work on the array vertically in order to optimize the vertical result along a audience area. And that is a significant revolution. It disrupt the way the designer were approaching the problem, and I believe that this is history that you know. They are perfectly aware that this disrupted completely the market, because the most of the product that had been introduced in the late 90s and in the beginning of 2000, they were immediately old when the line array came up, the line array as we know today came up in the market. So we want to focus, considering the line array something that is widely accepted as a solution, we want to see how a standard setup will interact with the performance space if we concentrate on the concert sound application. Of course, there are other kind of events that can have the same need of a concert sound. But let's think about the concert sound a little bit. So if we think about this interaction, we have to envision a space where if we are going to place the system from this position to here, let's say, whatever it would be in this area of the left and the right of the stage, we will have a space here in the middle where we should probably place the band. And in many applications that involve television, for example, we can have also orchestra, full orchestra in the area in the center between the two main systems. Eventually, we can have acoustic piano, and maybe voice if we're talking about opera recital, or maybe if we're talking about a political event or a social event, maybe we have somebody that has to give a speech, maybe being in this position or in this position or in this area, having the need for the best gain before the feedback. So if we consider how a system interact with this, we should consider also the idea that we could have, in addition to anything should happen here, we have also in many places like theater or maybe narrow concert room, we can have also the sidewall reflect the energy back into the audience area that is supposed to be here, this area. So if we design a vertical array system we know that most of the design for many brands are perfectly able to manage and control the directivity, even very well in some cases, if we consider the high frequency and the mid frequency region of the spectrum. The point is that when you refer to a line array module that is about 90 degree coverage, these 90 degrees are basically managed down to 400, 300, 200, depending on the array size, but generally is the best we can get. It would be down to about 200, and then below that, the directivity would be the natural directivity that a box of a specific dimension will have, because it's basically there would be nothing that is taking control of the directivity, but apart from the physical dimension of the box. So, but we believe that in order to improve the result in a practical application, there was the need of controlling that kind of energy, the dispersion of that kind of energy, because it's the energy that will be spread into the stage area and going on the sidewall as well, increasing the amount of reflected energy into a room or an environment. Then, of course, there is nothing bad having reflected energy. We always have reflected energy. But the point is that with a large-scale sound system, we generally have very good control down to a certain frequency. And so the reverberant energy down to that certain frequency will have some specific amount. And then below that frequency, the system will be free to disperse energy everywhere, and then the reverberant energy at those frequencies will immediately rise. And so the overall reverberant energy will be very rich at the mid-low and low end. So we believe that if we have a situation like this, where you have the general system, a general line array system dispersing energy that will going to feed part of the stage, we wanted to try to improve the situation and having something that where we can improve we can reduce by one order of magnitude the energy that would be dispersed on the center of the between the two systems, or and eventually on to the center of the stage. This generally we believe that if we could reduce this by an order of magnitude, it means about 10 or 12 dB, that give a much better a significant improvement in terms of gain before the feedback or cleanness. Okay, we can mention the advantages of all this stuff. So this is one of the advantage, but the other clear advantage is that if we reduce the energy radiating to this side, at the same time we are reducing a lot of energy that it will be radiated from the external side of the system, reducing the amount of mid base energy that is reflected back to the room. So in order to do that, you need a system that has an inherent directivity behavior that will be significantly different from just a box with the speakers mounted on the front of it. So we of course this was already part of the KRA heritage. So we decided to research around the concept of the dipole. In order to have it, to get the best out of it, without suffering from the fact that it tends to greatly reduce the amount of energy that you can radiate below some certain frequency. So the array model is a very, very simple concept. It's a basically a number of speakers that are arrayed on a panel, and this panel is mounted on sort of an open back loudspeaker that is. The open back loudspeaker is a very famous and well spread concept from the 50s, where you saw most of the guitar amplifier were open back speaker. Of course, this system will include a number of acoustical details that allows energy being radiated from the back, but with a significant reduction of intensity in order to not have a very intense radiation from the back. And also, if we have as much as radiation from the front, then from the back, we will have an acoustical cancellation, a short circuit, practically, acoustical short circuit that reduces the output at the low frequency. So we had to find a number of tricks in order to arrange acoustically the box inside, but so we optimize the amount of energy that is radiated from the back in order to be enough to have a significant cancellation on the side without disrupting the energy radiating from the front. And we decided also that we wanted to find an arrangement of this module that could be significantly easy to use and give some clear advantages when it's installed in a practical situation like concert or other kind of event, especially television, where people are that would be, if you have a very big and articulated array, it could be cumbersome and taking much of the visual space on the side. So this is the way the module is arranged internally. This is referred as KH8, that is part of the Firenze system, and is the first of a family. Now there is also a new family that came out that is called Concert Series. Alessandro will explain all this in detail. Anyway, in the KH8, there was this arrangement of eight inch woofers, and then other eight 4-inch woofer used as a mid range, and then a line of four compression driver in the center. This will be is the front of the box. The back of the box is incorporating this acoustic systems that we use. I would say this is a number of mechanical filters that are taking care of the back radiation, and there is a center part of the speaker that is housing the amplifier pack that is IP65 amplifier package that can survive under the rain, can operate not underwater, of course, but under heavy rain, the system can operate without being affected. And of course, we arrange internally the signal and the speaker. It would be to have a DSP channel that take care about of the low frequency. Then there is another DSP channel that take care about the mid frequency, and two DSP channel that they take care about two high frequency units, considering half of the box, and the rest it will be repeated by a second DSP unit that take care of the lower half of the box. So basically, we have two DSP two DSP board with eight processing channels with eight amplifier channels and a total of 16 speakers. Yes, 16. Okay, no, it's a four. Yeah, eight. Yeah, it's 20. Right. I still don't focus how many speakers we put inside. So we wanted to focus on why our idea of using this different directivity behavior is important. Of course, I believe that traditionally, whoever tried to act directivity control on the back radiation tended to concentrate on the back radiation itself. That is a good thing, of course, if you can reduce the back energy, is a nice thing. We came up with the idea that probably. Reducing the back radiation was important, is very important, but is not the most important thing that you have to do. So before concentrating on getting the best from the back, you probably have to be concentrated on getting the best from the side. And then you will do on the back whatever you can do. So if you take a conventional line array. Okay, in order, let me explain you. Of course, the interaction between these two surfaces is much more complex than this, if I was going to show the vector sum between them. I just wanted to concentrate on the energy dispersion, so that's why I decided to keep this simple and just show the power sum between them. Of course, you are... very familiar with this stuff, so you know that this pattern is much more complicated than that. Anyway, if we consider what happened when under Earth, if with this arrangement, still having a very reasonable output in the front, we were able to significantly reduce the energy along this line. And then if we analyze 125 and 160 and 200, so we design the way in order to keep this advantage constant. Of course, you can notice a big difference between these two arrangements when you place the system on the stage, or when you have system suspended at a low level. Of course, if you suspend a traditional system all the way to the top, then of course this six advantage will be reduced. But still, there will be one advantage that will remain in any case. Anyway, 250 to 315 and so on, 400, 500. And this is the area where this is a double. I took this example using a double 12-inch. That is a very diffused format for a line array element, and compared to what we can get with a KH8. And so, I'm sorry. Okay. So this just a little bit more about the array implementation. So we decided to use this kind of arrangement, like the Windows shutter, that allows to have the array perfectly aligned, perfectly vertical in every situation. So this kind of array can perfectly fit beside a video wall or in any kind of show. So it's not cumbersome compared to the video to a video wall and. Each one of the elements can be orientated by itself in a specific direction. Of course, if you do that, so this would be the side view. And the worst that you can have, that instead of having this side view flat, you will see a little bit of the box that is showing out of the shape of the array. Of course. You are perfectly aware that this kind of box arrangement will require a specific processing because if you try to sum all the contribution of these boxes in a position in a space, they will have all different delays. So you have to align them with a delay. Of course, we are doing much more than that. That's why when we decided to walk the road together to Stefan and to FMG, so we just decided to make a kind of skydive and a, and just to rely completely on something that allow us a completely free design of the array, because we could rely on technology that allow to align in time, to do time align on something that is inherently not time aligned. So you can easily imagine that several array configurations can be imagined, and so yeah, you can imagine many different kind of things. Maybe in an arena, you need to have something that is facing very far away and covering the very near area close to the stage. Maybe you can use it straight, or maybe an amphitheater, or maybe you can also emulate a spiral progressive array arrangement, like you could be very familiar with the line array element. And then, of course, you need a bunch of things to make it work, and so it was dedicated processor necessary. So each box need to be optimized with on a respect on the other, and so it was necessary this computer help. And so we decided to put anything together to take advantage of the FIR maker in order to have the box time aligned together, and then each one of the box optimized for a specific transfer function in order to have the resulting audience area covered by a very stable sound field. And of course we went more. We moved much more forward than that, because we moved the transfer function optimization to the transducer level, not just the box, but we are optimizing with a FIR maker the specific behavior of each one of the single transducers at the high frequency. And the mid frequency, we optimize each two transducers. Of course, the bigger wavelength allow us to reduce the number of optimization step into the geometrical arrangement. And at the low frequency, we optimize the box. So it's different from other application of the FIR maker. This is a multi-level optimization process. And of course, this would be the way you will interface with the system. You will not see anymore a banana-shaped array, but you will see this kind of exotic shape. And then, of course, you can work with the optimization of different of frequency response in different places of the venue. Of course, the interface will operate with a much bigger number of DSP channels, so it will be more sophisticated. But the FIR maker showed to be able to cope perfectly with this kind of problem. So, which I want to show. I want to bring to your attention what we found. This the overall arrangement of the system can give advantage into. So first of all, we have better low frequency distribution, and this keep having the stage clean from low frequency radiation, where low frequency is anything below 200, 250, and this, of course, having also reduced the emission to the wall. So which advantages come from this? First of all, the energy that you radiate on stage will be much less, let's say about 10 dB less or 12 dB less. So if this happens, it means that you need less volume from the stage monitors, for example, for those that use stage monitor, or for people that use in-ear, they have much less noise from all around. And so if you need less energy on stage, if you have less energy radiating on stage, you need less energy on stage, and then you have much better and cleaner sound quality from the microphone, and this it will be will improve the reinforcement, the sound that you get in the front for the audience, but also will improve the sound that you can record on live recording situations, or maybe in broadcasted live show. Another big improvement is the fact that you have much better stereo image, and in fact, most of the systems that are line array systems that are that maybe give 90 degree or 100 degree of coverage, since they have the low frequency energy spreading completely out of this angle at the lower below some certain frequency, when you walk close to the stage, you realize at some point that you lose completely the image of the scene. So you need a lot of energy from the front field in order to give the clarity and the intelligibility of what you're getting from the sound system. If you will be able to cut away most of this low frequency energy, you recover a much better consistency of this image in the front of the stage. So you will need a very little quantity of front field energy to complete the clarity that you need, and maybe mostly to shift the image down on stage instead of really giving energy. So you can give a very comfortable listening experience to the first rows that in many kind of show, those first rows are the most important, those that are also paying very high ticket. And you can also reduce the amount of energy that will be captured in the front of the stage. So where if you place an orchestra, maybe it'll be 60 or 80 elements orchestra just in a downstage, you know, in the center part, you can have a much better gain before the feedback with instruments like double bass, harp, piano, violin, and so on, so forth. So you improve, of course, the visual factor. Before the feedback, and this is the last, but not the least, because we don't have a box, so we are not using the resonant behavior of the box in order to get to have a low frequency. Of course, we pay this with a little bit of a reduction in efficiency at very low frequency, but the truth is that we don't have a resonant frequency at all into the low frequency reproduction. So there are a lot of the transient response on the low frequency is much better, and you get rid of a lot of box resonant behavior that you have to usually EQ'd out of the program material, and there is a possibility to perceive a much bigger number of nuances in a mix from the low mid energy. So this was anything. So I give the stage to Alex again. Okay, if you have any question, I'm here, or maybe we can discuss later.
Okay, thanks, Mario. We had in Japan a demo kind of a couple of months ago, and one of our sales guy was there, and when he came back, he reported to me an impression he had that I thought about when Mario was speaking. This demo was, in comparison with a lot of other system, very the big brands one, and they were inside in a big place, a big arena, with very reverberant environment. And the comment of this guy was, well, all the system were really good, so I'm not really a technician, I can't tell you which was the best. But something that happened is that when it was the time of KH8, I had the impression that somebody took out the wall. It looks like we were outdoor, because I couldn't feel anymore the reflections. So, and that's a behavior that is related to this SAT, what we call SAT technology, that allows you to avoid energy, a great part of the energy toward the sidewalls.
Sul palco siamo pronti, mancano 30 secondi. Veloci se mi fa. Ok, la chitarra è ok. Anche il basso è a posto. Avanti. Ok, batteria. Allora, Klaus Perale. Tutto ok lì, sistema tutto a posto?
Sì, Klaus, tutto ok. Tempo a parte ovviamente. Possiamo cominciare.
Funny enough, this presentation, it's a lot about weather. You can feel a storm, and it happened a lot of times during the beta testing period. We had 1 year of beta testing period of the system in China 2 years ago. We chose China because it's a very demanding place for a lot of reasons. You have all kind of weather there. It's so huge, from very hot in the south and very cold in the north. And the system was traveling for 1 year from north to south and back. And a lot of times the trucks had no suspensions, and on country roads the system was literally jumping inside the truck. It happened a couple of times that with forklift the system fell down because the operators are not always... And so you can imagine that it's been a very hard beta testing period. And a couple of festivals, one of them, I believe Mario was there, they call it Mud Festival because it was 3 days of rain and mud like that. You cannot really walk there. And it's something that is really about the system. So the system itself is made by aluminium. It's an aluminium frame, Avio aluminium, and all the grill are stainless steel, and the external frame is stainless steel. So this frame that in which there are all the wirings allows to fly till 24 panel with 10-to-1 safety ratio coefficient. So it's a huge amount of speakers that really normally you don't need. What's important about the system is that we packaged inside a lot of power in terms of DSP, just like Mario already explained, but also a lot of power in terms of watts. You see here, this data is really a bit conservative because the amps inside, each channel is able to deliver 100 volts RMS with 40 amps of pitch current output. So it's really... Ah, sorry, you're right, there's a mistake there. Yeah. It's not 1.5, but it is 2.5, the voice coil of the drivers, of the compression drivers. So basically, inside every speaker, you have two power supply, 8 channels that are more close to 2.5 kilowatt, 2.5 watts, sorry, kilowatt. Yes. And there are 2 DSP board. And if you give a check, it's normally 2 times or sometimes 4 times the power that normally is applied on an line array element. Of course, having the amps on board allows very short wirings. You have no loss in the lines. And it helps also on the damping factor. You have 160 libras, 72 kilograms per each panel. And you will see a short presentation later how easy and quick it is to set them up. So it takes really 5 minutes, 2 guys to fly an array. the sub that is the companion of the KH-8 and also of the KH-7 is a double 21 with this kind of loading. You can see the 221 here, and those are the reflex port. And it's driven by an IPAL module from PowerSoft. So there's the motion control and all the kind of feature that probably some of you already knows from this module of PowerSoft. This is theoretically the small brother, but it's a bad beast too. It's the only element I know in the market that can be flown horizontally or vertically. So you can create with the same element vertical or horizontal array. You have four 12 coaxial transducers inside with a special weight guide and horn that you can mechanically rotate. So you can change the polar partner of each one. Normally, of course, you move all together. That's the way to do that. It means that when you use vertically, you can decide to have a narrow dispersion, for example, for side field application on stage. You don't want to spread eyes on the venue. So you can rotate the horns and keep the 30 degrees polar pattern as a vertical pattern. Or otherwise, you can keep straight and rotate to have the largest 100 degrees polar pattern for the horizontal one. You can do the same both when you fly vertically or horizontally. And what's amazing about this system is that when you fly horizontally, you can steer in three dimensions. So you can steer both vertically and horizontally with the four different sources that you have aligned horizontally. Inside we have a steel 1DSP board, is the same of the KH-8, but there were two, and one of the two modules that are also in the KH-8. This kind of module are eating everything. So you go from almost 70 volts to 265 with almost no loss in power. So they are really keeping the same output power force. Of course, they are dragging much more current from the main AC. What's more about this system? It's almost a full range system, even if normally for the most part of application a sub extension is needed. It's very light. If you check the power, the SPL capability and all the features included, it's still very light, still an aluminum frame and still IP degree.
Everybody knows in our job that enemy number one is the time. The KH-8 system by KRA is set up in less than 5 minutes. The only thing I need for flying the system is a pencil, two motors, power cable, signal cables, and a shank. And now I have hanged the system. And I'm ready to go up. The rotation of every box is independently adjustable. Now the system is ready. Let's get it off.
This dolly that was in the presentation was the six element dolly. We have got as well another one that is a three element dolly. You can combine them together when you are loading on a track. The six element is suggested if you are mechanically moving, so forklift or hydraulic sponge, and the three element is suggested if you normally handily move them. Everything is already pre-wired, so every three elements you have on one side two pin and a power con, connector that is a Soka connectors. On the other side you have other two pin to connect and the multi-pin 25-pin connector that is bringing network, digital audio, analog audio, everything you need to for all the speakers. So every two element is a very simple operation. The mechanical joint is made in a way in which you don't need to put the pin in one hole, but it's a big delta hole, so it's easy to plug the pin. As soon as you rise the motor, goes in the center automatically. So even if the ground is not really flat, it's very easy to join them, to combine them. Here is the KH7. In the horizontal application array, you have also the possibility to stack them on the basement. Of course, it's quite easy to plug them. There's a plate between them that you can fit in this way or in that way. So you just remove it and slide it again, and it becomes vertical or horizontal. And this plate stays on board normally. So it's quite easy to operate. The same, but in vertical configuration. Of course, you can do long arrays. In this case, is a perfect solution for theaters. There are tools all around that are using this kind of, with two, three, or four elements in theaters. It's perfect for delay towers. It's perfect for side fields, both on stage and to cover the side of the stage, the bleacheries on the side of the stage. The weight allows to fly really easily. In this way, you have already 2.5 meter of array with just a little bit more than 100 kilogram. KSA, the SAP, can be moved for smaller application on his own wheels, so just one element. Or otherwise, you can move two or three of them on the dollies. The onboard wheel can be easily removed by sliding them. So you push a button and you slide them out. Here, they are sharing the same mechanic with KH8. So it is very easy to install the same flying bar of the KH8. You can fly them straight on top of the KH8 and then an array of KH8 on the bottom. Well, I will not invest that much time because Mario already explained a lot about this slim array technology, that the key features is not really about the possibility to keep the speaker small and slim but it is everything that Mario already explained. So it's the hypercardioid shape of the dispersion at the low, mid, and lows, and the possibility of having a better ratio between direct and reflected sound inside when you are indoor, and the advantages are not having a resonant high volume in a box. It's small. These are three panel of KHA stacked. You can lift them on the dolly, of course. So you just run the dolly on the stage and they can stay there. This is a kind of a complicated situation. It's a nightmare theater. is something that took us some time to let people understand, because in this kind of application, everybody is accustomed to work with 4, 5, 6 tops stacked on the ground to achieve the angle that you need. And also, in that case, you normally don't achieve the result you want, because you have not that many speakers to focus back. So you can play with few of them, and the angles that each speaker can provide is not that much if we are speaking about big arrays. In this case, thanks to the digital steering, this is what happened, just mechanically bending them without digital steering. And what this is what you can achieve using FearMaker. So you can perfectly cover the audience with just 3 pieces. It is to be said, Mario explained a bit, that in reality, each panel includes 2 speakers. So it means that somehow we are playing with 6 of them, and with the high frequencies, we have 12 of them, because every KH8 has got 3-4 channels for the compression driver to drive them. Once again, Stefano already explained, but this is what happened with and without the FEAR application. At different frequencies, same concept. So, as I told you, for more than 1 year, we beta tested the system in China. China was also for us the first market, together with the United States at that time. Now also is one of the biggest markets for us. There were a lot of festivals and a lot of companies that were already using our previous system. So it was kind of easy to do all the beta testing part there. And from 2013, October, up to the end of 2014, the system traveled all around, and there were really a lot of live gig and also some permanent installation.
Technology system in the world. It really rocked the crowd tonight. So, yeah.
This was the best sound we've had, man. It's crystal clear out in the audience. We loved every minute of it. Thank you.
Yeah. We'll be right back.
we play, you know, we play a lot of shows where people are traveling with giant PA systems, and if you can, you can carry around just as much sound without so much equipment always having to do it, I'm sure it's going to be a great...
To be said about this beta testing period is that despite of the kind of treatment the system received, we had really few technical issues there. So it means that the pre-period that we did in Italy with an Italian company probably already debugged 99% of the system. And what's happened there, luckily enough, is that a lot of international band with their sound guys played with the system. So the news about it was spread all over, and that made really easier the year after the introduction on other markets. So to go ahead, we can see fixed installations for club. This is a crazy club in Shanghai. It's very huge one, very, very nice one. And in this case, we tried also that the speaker is not only waterproof, but is also champagne proof. I was there for the opening ceremony of this place, and it was champagne all over. They start spreading champagne everywhere, and the system was full, probably. You can see it. And there, what's nice really is that there were an impressive SPL in the center of the place, but was still nice to listen to it. So it was not really aggressive. Then, what's there? Okay, that another big festival there. That's a very nice application. This is in Kitzbühel in Austria for ski championship last year. For this kind of application, I believe that probably you would have an hard life with any other system, because the KH8 was installed at the end of the ski track and was shutting up the hill. We have other pictures. So it was a up tilt mechanically about, if I'm not wrong, 20-25 degrees. If you need to do that with the banana, it gets almost impossible to do that. There was minus 10, a lot of snow on it. So that was another very nice test. And that was the preview of the installation. So you can see this loop here was shutting up the hill. And that was the difference in SPL, the average SPL, that was 200 meter up of the hill. Then Brazil, with Gabizon, maybe some of you knows those companies, a very huge one. They are crazy enough. This time there were 30,000 people, 30, with 6 panel aside. Some more picture. This is a Yahoo convention in the Lincoln Center in New York City. It's easy to see the system flow, see 6 panel aside as well. This is a a very nice open air arena in San Diego, in which we did some demo and some shows with the system this year, last year in 2015. I'm the president and one of the co-founders of KRA. What to say? You will see yourself. The Firenze Lion, especially the KH8, is for us our baby, is our race car, our Ferrari. And since the moment we started to design it, we put all ourselves in this line. I'm sure you will enjoy it. I want to thanks again, both Rick and Michael, for everything they are doing and everything they did. A big hug from Alex. Ciao. Take care.
You imagine a class of about 30 little brothers and sisters singing Peanut Butter. Or doing background to our lead singer of the class, Aquanetta Butts, as she sang.
You know, walking in, I happened to walk in with a production manager, and I could see the look in his eye, and the look that he had was, wow, this would be great for production. It looks like it will pack into a 18-foot space. And so based on first seeing it, I thought the production is going to love this.
I was blown away. I was sitting in the very back row, and you can feel it, and I know that they wasn't pushing it all the way.
I'll be truthful with you. Most of the times I go out on tour with this amount of sound, I carry a lot more boxes than
a lot, yeah, more boxes.
Yeah, a lot more than this. And quite frankly, there's a lot of sound for this few boxes and this amount of weight that's being flown. And it's I was impressed. Coverage was magnificent. Quite frankly, we walked at least about 500 feet back, and it sounded pretty much the same as it did up front. I mean, the coverage was very good. I didn't feel any dead spots. No walking up front, you know, the people weren't being burned out. It wasn't a burnout kind of thing, you know, where it's too loud. No, it was smooth from the front stage all the way to the back, way behind the front of the house.
How far back behind the front of the house would you say you walked it?
I walked another 200 feet behind. You know, we're outside. And
OMG. No, really, it was OMG. I couldn't believe the clarity and, you know, after we played some tracks, the punch. It's a very, very, very nice PA. Mm-hmm. See, this having an advantage is in cost. Cost to the act, cost to the production personnel. It sounds incredible, so if it was a one-to-one situation, this would win out.
Wow.
Well, this video is a bit embarrassing to me, but we didn't pay them. Believe me, we couldn't afford. So they paid for their flight to listen to the system, and they were really impressed. So the place there was not really easy because it's quite a deep loop and it's very deep. And we didn't apply any kind of delay tower, so we were lucky there was no wind, but we were covering till the end of the place. And it was very, very constant. The coverage was unbelievable constant. That's another event, and you can see the KH7 stacked in front of the stage. That's another big event this summer in Central Park, 12 aside. We had delay towers with KH7 in these places, but there were really a lot of people there. You can see a delay tower becomes nothing. It's easy to set up, it's almost invisible. It's much more related to the truss than to the speakers themselves. So that's the end of the presentation. As you could see, for us is a kind of a Formula One system, and of course we are in need of Formula One team to manage and to approach it. Mario said the system cannot operate without a software help, without all the electronics that's inside, but of course the operator should be able to operate it properly, and as soon as you get confident with it, you can achieve what you want with it. There's really a lot of margin and a lot of power, and you can get basically what you want from it. So I'm ready to answer your question. Yeah, I believe Dave and Sam are going to give a calendar, because the system is going to be on tour in UK soon.